thank you very much, everyone, for bearing with us. As you can see, I'm having some serious technical difficulties, but we're half an hour late, so I figured I had to get started. Welcome to episode 2. Our topic today is space opera. We have a guest, and I'm going to let them introduce themselves and, you know, mention what might be relevant to today. And we'll start with the left of my screen, which would be Anne. And in the meantime, I'll see if some up and running.
All right. So I guess since I'm Anne and I'm on the left of the screen, I'm Anne Leckie, and I'm the author of Ancillary Justice and Ancillary Sword and Ancillary Mercy, which are space operas. And I'm not sure who's next. Who's next down the line? It looks like Kalita might be.
I'm Kalita Muhammed-Ali. I'm a co-editor over at podcastle.org, occasional narrator. And I'm also a writer, not of space opera so much, although I've written a little. But these days I write, I would say, more sci-fantasy. But I am a lover of space opera. And I'm not sure who's next, because there's...
I think Chandra's next, at least in my little set of tiles, so.
All right. Hi, I'm Chandra True Love Fry, and I'm a multi-genre author. I like to dabble in just about every genre I can get my hands on. I am currently working on a space opera anthology that I'm heading up called 42 and Beyond. And it's kind of a slight tribute to The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And I hope to have many more different science fiction and space operas in the future.
Well, I think that leaves me by default then. I'm Bonnie Milani. I know how to bring my picture up here. I don't know if we're supposed to do that automatically or not. Okay. If I touch it, it'll blow. Bonnie Milani, author of Homeworld, which is epic space opera, as well as a number of novellas all set in the Homeworld universe.
And thank you, everyone, for introducing yourselves. I'm sorry if I'm still lagging here. My name is Diane Morrison. I'm your host, manager of the SFWA YouTube channel. And I am, I'm not merely decorative on this panel today. I'm actually a space opera author myself. I've got a couple of publishers, and I am working on a series called The Toy Soldier Saga, which is a space. So I'm very excited about this topic today. I'm going to continue to try to log in on the computer that I have set up here, which has better memory than this one. I'm sorry I had a malfunction on my major computer today, which is the source of the issue. So why don't we start with what is space opera? And there's no wrong answer. I would be very interested in all of your opinions, ladies. Go ahead, whoever wants to start.
Go, Bunny.
you guys already know who's got the big mouth on here, right? Space opera for me, it's a story, it's a sci-fi story that deals with the large, epic romance and space battles and thrones and kings. Game of Thrones and Waikiki is how my book's been described. But it's for me, it has so much room in it to explore the human condition. It doesn't have to be the classic 1930s kind of story that was aimed at 16-year-old boys. It has room to explore the human side of what science and technology can do to the species, not just our own, but to other species that we can imagine. You know, for me, C.J. Cherry is one of my go-to people for what space opera can be in dealing with looking at humanity from a totally different perspective. Next.
Yeah, I agree that the large backdrop is very important. Sometimes I hear people say that there have to be big space battles and the universe at stake, and I'm not sure that's necessarily the case. I mean, that's always fun because who doesn't like the universe at stake and great big space battles? But I often feel like the sort of essence of space opera is the sort of almost operatic, brightly colored, highly pitched, very dramatic, even melodramatic, maybe not necessarily scientifically accurate, but bringing in all those really cool things that just seem very sparkly and beautiful and dramatic, to me, make a thing space opera.
I think for me, what's important is the big backdrop, but even more so, the small stories on top of that. So when I think space opera, the first thing that comes to my mind is, for example, Firefly and the lives of these people and their little trials in the midst of what's going on in this great big universe. And their issues are small in the greater scheme of things, but they matter a big deal to them. For me, those are the stories that matter the most to me. I could care less what happens with the big governments and the big fights. I want to know what's happening with the little people.
I agree. I like that. For me, I like the variety that space opera offers. You've got anywhere from Star Wars to Spaceballs to Dune. You know, they could be comedy. They could be space pirates. You know, the variety is just amazing out there, and it gives you a vast world to work in.
Yeah. I think Khalid had a really good point about emphasizing the small lives, because as much as people talk about, oh, the stakes are huge and the galaxy is at stake, it matters that the galaxy is at stake because of the people who, you know, the individual lives. And I think that's the thing that's important. And very often the big stakes seem bigger. We understand them better when we understand how they affect individuals, not kings and queens and space emperors, but the actual people who are trying to live their lives. I think that's a really good point.
Yeah, in a way it's like it gives us a chance to rewrite history. Because so much of our own history focuses only on the big names. It focuses only on royalty, only on the major players, whereas history itself actually progresses in the collection of all these stories of all the little people. And I think great space opera never loses sight of that, that if you lose sight of it, you lose sight of the story, you lose the heart of the story, you lose your readers, because it steps away from the emotional, the heart and the soul of what makes any kind of fiction work. And that is being able to engage with the characters, to care about them. Firefly does that beautifully. A lot of what goes into Star Wars and makes Star Wars so great and Star Trek so great is that you have these little people who they're not the major characters in the story, but it's one of the ancillary characters who actually it's going to be the story of those people who are technically in the background. Well, you follow the heroes, we follow the names you're following, Star Trek and Spock and Kirk and them, but it's not that episode is not their story. They are moving it, but it's somebody else's story. I think that's one of the things space opera does so much better than almost any other subtext, subgenre of sci-fi. So what are you saying? Does that sound something? It sounds along your lines.
Can we talk some more? Let's see. I agree that C.J. Cherry is a really good, an author who does that really well, where she has the huge backdrop and she focuses on the characters, just the individual characters living through things. I agree, Firefly is a really good example of that. I do love Firefly for that. To some extent, Star Wars and Star Trek, you're right, they kind of fall into the, these are the people who are, you know, the Galactic Emperor is the captain who has the huge battleship, but there's a lot of interest in those, in those other characters that sometimes Star Trek doesn't, or didn't, I should say, the original Star Trek didn't use to its full potential, but I guess that wasn't what it was doing. Because that's the next thing, is different space operas do very different things and they have very different aims. And one of the, I think it was Chandra said, there's such a variety in space opera. It can do all kinds of different things. I find it really fabulous just for how many different kinds of stories you can tell, even though stereotypically it does one particular kind. I think actually space opera has the ability to cover a huge amount of ground and a lot of different themes.
Okay.
I think we can.
Yay! All right, there's an echo. I know why I'm shutting.
Awesome. You know, in the interim, what do you think is the, you know, we hear so much about hard sci-fi and soft sci-fi. Do you think that's a part of space opera?
I think that hard and soft sci-fi can both fit into space opera. And it's more about, space opera is more about just kind of, I don't know, for me, it kind of has just, it's more action-packed, it's more dramatic. It almost always has this kind of feel good atmosphere, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Maybe that's why we all love it, because you know, there's always this upbeat kind of, even in the darkest hour, the good guy's gonna win in space opera.
Exactly.
Yeah, I can't get into doom and gloom and the world is going to end and richly deserved. It's like no, okay, it's gonna end, okay. I'm not going to talk about it.
Well, I think you can do that kind of story with space opera. I think you're right. You can do hard. You can do soft. You can do any sort, which I think is really fabulous. I prefer the happy ending. And sometimes we kind of need happy endings. I feel like sometimes I don't mind a good tragedy, right? It can be really the kind of thing that you need. But sometimes I get a little frustrated at the way that tragedies and tragic endings are treated as more serious and more important than something that is trying to be hopeful. They both have their place, and I can't see one as being more important than the other, and yet they get treated that way sometimes. And that can be, you know, so sometimes people kind of go, oh, space opera, less than they used to. I'm glad that's changed a lot. It's changed a lot from back, when was it when people were really, when space opera was an insult rather than, ooh, a gosh, cool thing, right? But yes, I think space opera can be diamond hard if you really want it to be. I think space opera is an attitude more than, you know, a set of prescriptions.
I also think I think there can be hope in an ending that has loss. I actually don't mind an ending that isn't the happily ever after, particularly if there is some kind of lesson or some sense that we've gained something out of that, or some sense that we're going to go somewhere from here in that ending. if it was just a tragic ending for the sake of a tragic ending, it sort of is meaningless. But if you have that tragic ending and you know that whatever happens, we can take something from this and like do something better with it, there's that sense of hope. I'm for that just as much as I am the happy ending.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense, actually. And I hadn't thought of that when I was talking, but I think you're absolutely right. And I feel like stories often, even the most fantastic stories, give us a template for how to handle things in our own lives. And there's a huge value to a story where it seems like everything's lost, but you know there's hope. That's a super important narrative to have, a super important story to tell, because 9 times out of 10, when things happen in your life, it's not the end of the world. It's not the universe is over. It feels like it. I've had things in my life happen where it felt like my life was over, but it wasn't. And that's an important thing to tell a story about. Absolutely.
I agree 100% with you, Anne. And I agree with you that space opera is more so of an attitude. I guess space opera is like the personality of sci-fi, you know?
But if I can butt in here, and I'm fascinated by your term diamond heart, that space opera can be diamond heart. What would be an example of diamond heart space opera, do you think?
Oh, I really don't know, to be honest, off the top of my head, because it doesn't tend to be, does it? But honestly, I'll reveal my cynicism here. I think the hardest of hard science fiction is generally more science-y than scientific. People talk a good game about, oh, we got all the physics right, but my parents were biologists and they would see a science fiction film and laugh, literally laugh out loud at the biology. And some folks try and get the physics right, but there's inevitably stuff that doesn't come out right. And that's life. I mean, as a writer, what are you going to do? Stuff isn't going to come out right all the time. You're going to do your best. But then to stand up and say, well, my science fiction is truly scientific and your stuff with the wormholes and the laser sword battles is just fantasy. Well, honestly, you know, so I guess I usually gauge hardness by the intention. If the author's trying to get the physics and the biology right, then yeah, but I think there's an attitude. I think we actually gauge the hardness of science fiction by its attitude. So even if something has extremely correct physics as much as possible and their biology is impeccable, but it's got the space opera stuff around it, people aren't going to look at that as hard science fiction, whereas something is set in a single solar system and has a particular approach where the plot is about solving an engineering problem, people are going to think of that as hard science fiction, whether or not the science is much more accurate than in the space opera story.
That makes a lot of sense.
Do you think, I will always jump in. Do you think then that, that it's always bothered me when I encounter literary circles? I just went through this recently in a reading group for my alma mater, where the group absolutely refuses to read science fiction because it's, in their opinion, they really don't regard it as proper literature. And so we challenge the group to read sci-fi. And what they chose to read was Chinese science fiction, which is fascinating in its own right, but The Three Bodies Problem, which is super hard physics-oriented science fiction with characters that are nothing more than stick figures there to advance the plot with no attempt to develop the character whatsoever. And what we got back, of course, is people saying, oh, well, see, that's what science fiction is. And it seems to me that space opera, by its very nature, counteracts that kind of disregard for the human condition, that the story, I think that this is something I'd like to hear your opinions on. What is it that creates this opinion, this disregard for space opera in literary circles?
Logic?
But how so? Is it real because we have logic or because they didn't have logic?
I know the story I'm writing for 42 and beyond, I was sharing the outline with my husband, and he goes, "It doesn't work like that," and started giving me all the scientific things that I was wrong on my story. And I'm just like, okay, but it's a space opera.
You know, I think that when we are writing and particularly reading or watching any kind of speculative fiction, we walk in the door willing to lay some things aside. And I think for me, I am not a scientist, and I do have some science knowledge, but I'm not a scientist. What I require is for you to tell that story in such a way that I want to believe what you're telling me. So there are many times when I know this science is not right, but I am willing to walk this road with you. So if you can tell the story well enough, I will go with you on this journey and I will follow you to the end of it. That is all you have to do. You don't have to get the science perfectly right, but you do need to get enough of it right so that it doesn't look like a wonky mess to me. I mean, but at the same time, when I'm writing a story, I have to often remind myself, this is a fantasy. I can make this up if I want to. And we have that leeway to do that. So I think that for people who are nitpicking the crap out of this, they're not really there to truly enjoy the story anyway. And you can't satisfy all those people. You just can't.
I think there's additional stuff going on too, especially when more literary oriented folks read science fiction and come away dissatisfied with it. And it's not just because they might have picked an example that maybe wasn't very strong in characterization or whatever it was. I feel like science fiction and fantasy, many of us, maybe not all of us, but very many readers, we've read for a long time, ever since we were kids, and we've learned to read science fiction and fantasy. It has a set of conventions that by now we understand. There are shorthands and ways of depicting things that make sense to us as experienced readers of science fiction and fantasy. Literary fiction, quote unquote, it's all literary, it's all written down. Literary fiction is its own genre with its own set of conventions that literary readers have learned to read over time, but they as kind of as we do too, so I'm not trying to throw shade on literary readers, tend to think of the good things about literary fiction as universally applicable rather than particular conventions that they learned to read this particular genre. And so they come to science fiction without the background of reading or of experience of reading the conventions, without having read various things that we all kind of take for granted. And it reads as flat and hollow to them because there are no strings to resonate because they don't have that set of experience. And they say, well, this is flat and meaningless. And it just reinforces things that people might say about genre outside. I do think that that's changing some. We've seen a lot of folks, a lot of well-regarded mainstream literary writers use science fictional techniques, use them very well. We've had a number of people who are unabashedly science fiction fans write things that were just sort of on the edge between and have them very well received. And so I think a lot of that is changing. But there's still some. My daughter's lit teacher said that genre was just a set of conventions and literary fiction could explore anything. And I just went, oh, God, please, no. But I do think we kind of underestimate how much we've trained ourselves to read science fiction and fantasy, and how much our experience as science fiction and fantasy readers really enriches and informs our reading of science fiction and fantasy.
Well, would you agree with me that we read science fiction and fantasy to escape the literal world, if you will? It's not to be taken seriously, especially space opera. It's fantastical. It's the high fantasy of space. You know, it's to enjoy for the excitement and the adventure, not to be taken literally, if that makes sense.
It makes sense. And I think, different readers read for different reasons. And the question of whether we read science fiction and fantasy for escape or just purely entertainment, I think that's a really complicated issue, because different people are going to be entertained by and escape with different things, even within science fiction and fantasy. And I have to admit, I believe that even the most frivolous narrative is extraordinarily important. Just personally, I believe that we use narrative to organize our response to the world and to understand the world around us. And so the narratives that we're ingesting, the stories that we read, become templates for how we decide to react to the world around us. And what those stories are becomes very important. At the same time, you know, I sit down, I want to read something, I want to blow some things up and feel like the hero and kind of relax and enjoy things. So I'm not going to say I think every story needs to be deathly serious, but I will say that saying it should be for escape is not a simple thing. You have who's escape? Who is the narrative designed to facilitate their escape? Who is it entertaining? Who is it not entertaining? All these things are so it's a complicated thing, I think.
I think escape is not the word I would use for myself. I ingest science fiction through books, through my games. And escape is a hard word because I use it to re-envision myself sometimes. And I use it to re-envision myself in this present sometimes. I don't know if I would use the word escape. I don't know. It's a difficult thing to describe, but I'm not always satisfied with how I exist in this space, in this present. So I can take it there and be a different person in a video game and remake myself there for this time. I guess it's escapism, but it's something more. It's something bigger than that. Because I immerse myself, I become that person for that period of time. It feels like more than escape to me. So I kind of take it seriously when I'm there.
Yeah, and I feel like the kind of thing that you're talking about, it's not just in the game. It's not just in the book. It's a thing that you bring back to real life, right? At least in my experience, you bring it back and it's part of yourself. And that really informs how you respond to other things around you. It on the most simplistic level, like, oh, I come back more confident because I got to, you know, succeed at this thing in this particular way. My existence was recognized in this story. And so when I'm in the world, I can be myself more surely and more solidly. All those kinds of things, they add up. And escape would be one word, but I think you're right. Escape maybe isn't exactly the right word.
Definitely.
Has anybody, I'll shut up.
I was just going to say, so what word would describe it appropriately?
I don't know that I have the right word. I don't know what that right word is for me. I don't know.
I think it might have been Hal Duncan who referred to those kinds of stories as being refreshed, like finding a drinking fountain or a spring and quenching a thirst as much as escaping, right?
Yeah, or it's escaping and other things, but not just escape. I mean, yeah, escape is part of it, but I'd say refreshing myself is also part of it. Becoming, growing, strengthening.
I think you've so really got something there. Like, I think that for me, space opera and maybe superheroes, right, are the two big current mediums of modern myth, right? We tend to see ourselves in myths. Myths are about us. They're about our stories and who we are and how we can be more than ourselves, but still fully ourselves, right? So I think we find ourselves, I think you're exactly right, not escapism, refreshing our sense of self, refreshing what we can be, refreshing our connection to all of humanity, maybe.
You know, you just scooped me, Diana, because that was exactly the point I wanted to make. That what we've
lost. Sorry.
The thing that we've lost, as science has progressed, we have lost that ability, that sense of wonder at the universe, that ability to look up the night sky. I'm in Los Angeles, you can't even see the night sky. But the ability to look up at the stars and see wonder and see stories and see myth. So it seems to me that what we've done here with space opera is create a new mythology, a form of literature that gives us back the sense of wonder, that lets us recreate the wonder. And I think that's exactly what superheroes do. That's exactly what huge stories that grow out of the trials and tribulations of little people. That's exactly what this is. One of the reasons that annoys me so greatly when I hear the literary types dismiss sci-fi is because it's space opera that inspired our last two generations of astronauts and scientists to get us to the moon. It's space opera that inspired people to put us into, you know, to get us onto Mars. Without it, that sense of wonder, I think, would be vastly diminished, that we don't have any place left. You know, how it's so hard to believe in miracles anymore. Can we create them in this marvelous genre? What do you think?
Did you ever see that documentary, William Shatner hosted it? I don't remember the title exactly, something like How Star Trek Saved the World or something like that, right? I mean, so it's exactly what you're saying. So much of our technology, so many of our innovations, right, came from science fiction, came from space opera. Engineers and technicians and scientists read these stories and were inspired by these stories and said, hey, let's make that. And they did, you know?
Yeah. It's just like, I work with genetic engineering in my books. It's like, yeah, anything technical than that, I'm in deep trouble. But the thing that is almost scary is to see when I wrote Homeworld, I worked with genetic engineers to work out the technology to make sure that the methodology I described really does work and is in use or can be used. What's scary now is that the human polymorphs I was talking about at that time are being designed. So it's a mythology, but it's a mythology that actually can come real. And yeah, I think space opera can guide us. It helps to guide and shape the way we think about what technology can do and how it could be used. What do y'all think?
Well, we've definitely seen it in, you know, like was mentioned about Star Trek. We have tablets now and touch screens and, you know, all those things that were, you know, science fiction are actually happening. So I completely agree.
Lasers, lasers, lasers.
Yep. Where's my flying car, damn it?
There's a prototype out. There's a couple of prototype out. One that just came out. It's an electric flying car.
And I don't know, guys. I want replicators and teleporters. Come on.
I'll be with McCoy on the teleporter, though.
I was going to say, I'm not sure I want teleporters and replicators. It opens up a philosophical can of worms. It's very disturbing. Star Trek never went that way, but the few times it did, it was like, we're shutting the door on this question. We don't want to even look behind that door. And it's really disturbing when you start pondering the implications of transporters and replicators.
We're sort of getting replicators. We have 3D printers now. They're starting to reprint all kinds of things.
Well, 3D printers are pretty awesome. Yeah.
As long as we're not reprinting me.
Right.
That's right.
The problem. But no, that's the power of narrative. Narrative can literally change the world just by telling a story. And it's not just stuff like, oh, we have flip phones now. Stories can change the world. They change the way people react with the world. They can change everything. So stories are really powerful that way.
That's true. That's why a dictator comes to power. They burn the books. Occasionally the authors, but they always burn the books.
That is very true. Or they make it so difficult to find the books that they might as well be burned. Yeah, exactly. You're so right there.
But that has to be, and you know, that's part of what you see here. Is that I don't, outside of Fahrenheit 451, I try to remember, I can't off the top of my head think of another story that really deals with what happens when a society bans books. I think we're finding out the hard way for ourselves what happens, but the idea of having books that our ideas be banned. And then we see what happened in the Soviet Union, we see it happens in China, you see what happens in Iran, of people saying, well, if we can't get them one way, we'll get them another. And the banning in and of itself gives these books, gives these narrative stories vastly more power and influence than they would have had otherwise. Look at Salman Rushdie. Whoever heard of Salman Rushdie until Khomeini went and put a death threat, you know, put a fatwa on him. If Khomeini had left the man alone, nobody would still have heard of Salman Rushdie.
Well, I don't know. I don't want to go down that particular road, because now we're going to get into dystopia.
That's right.
Yeah, okay. So I'm sorry I missed a good deal of the start of this conversation, getting organized. So I hope that I'm not covering ground that has already been covered. But another thing that I think is really cool about space opera that I don't think we get in, I mean, you can get it in other genres, but it's more difficult, right? And I think that is the idea of different cultures, right? Like as Ursula Le Guin put it, right? You can imagine other ways of being, and you can imagine ways in which, you know, we don't have to do things this way because this is the way we have always done these things. We can do things different ways. I really like that about, I read Ancillary Justice, and I really like that about your book, Anne. I really like the fact that, you know, These are different cultures. They don't quite look like any culture on Earth. They have some elements of them, and you can see the DNA, I guess, right? But it's not really any existing Earth culture, and how that intersection of cultures, that's a big issue, right? I mean, early space opera was very much about that whole, we're going to go forth where no man has gone before, and I use man deliberately in that sentence, right? And it was very much about, okay, you know, we're going to discover things, and we're going to, you know, spread our ideas all over the place. And it was very colonial, right? And now I think that we're taking a different take on it. We're starting to look into the subtle issues, right? What happens when two cultures collide, right? You know, like, I don't know. I'd be interested in your guys' feelings on that and your take on that.
It is a potential strength of space opera. It's one that not every writer particularly wants to deal with or chooses to deal with in the time-honored Planet of the Hats mode, right? Everybody from this planet is this, everybody from this planet is that. But it is a potential strength of space opera that it can do that. I do think space opera's colonial roots are a thing that are worth thinking about because the standard template, the standard space opera adventure story is very much sort of an heir to colonial adventure fiction, imperialist adventure fiction. And that's a thing to think about. And it does affect the way that other cultures can be depicted in space operas. They can seem very monolithic, or everybody who isn't our central white, almost exclusively male human Earth culture is, they're all, you know, primitive or savages or wrong about one thing or another or whatever. That's a thing to watch out for. But it is certainly, it's a set of powerful tools that space opera absolutely can use, that I think it's worth anybody who wants to write space opera thinking very seriously about using them.
Yeah, I think that the idea of colonialism isn't always well handled in a lot of space opera. And when I say well handled, I mean it is often written with the old sort of white Euro colonial type ideals in mind. And what is the name of the book that Le Guin wrote? The name of it just...
Are you thinking of the word for world is forest?
Yes, which I think was awesome. Really hit on our sort of attitudes about creating colonies in other places and just the sort of racist attitudes that we have, our sort of our way is better than your way sort of attitude of doing things. And I think that it is often glossed over the effects that we might have on other peoples when we go somewhere else and just set down roots. And I think these types of things should be explored more often. The effects that we might have on other people, or the effects that just any other group might have on another people, just settling down might have on another group. I think that should be explored more often. But I think when it's seen in a negative light, it's often when it's happening to other humans as opposed to when other humans are doing it to other people. I would love to see more of that.
Yeah, one of the things that CJ Cherry worked on or worked with was just how difficult it is for different species with different genetic needs, genetic makeup, different brain structures, how difficult it is for them to even be sure that that they understand what each other is saying. She created a species called the Taka and the Chi for her Chanar series. And the Taka are methane breathers that have multi-part-type brains that where the thought processes, where she presented them in a grid format. And so you had words going across and words coming down. And no one was ever really sure that they knew what these guys were saying. So that there was a matter of how do you even know for sure that you have understood what the other culture is saying? That the community, and that for me is a fascinating aspect that we don't really know ever with another culture how deeply off, how far off are we, and from that innocent misunderstanding can grow horrendous, but horrendously severe consequences. Mm-hmm. I think my one is just like Australia. How do we get the name of the word kangaroo? Yeah. Where a British captain asks the local Aborigine, which is, what is that creature there? And the answer was kangaroo, which translates as you're too stupid to understand.
Good stuff.
What's that cartoon that came out not too long ago where an astronaut goes to another planet and he meets a new species, but they turn it around where he's the alien. I thought that was genius. Because it's almost always we're the ones who think they're the aliens. But if we're on another planet, that makes us the alien.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, CJ Cherry does a great job of that too, I find. She's very good at portraying her other people, which do not, you know, they're that classic statement, right? Give me, what is it? How does it go? Give me an intelligent being that, you know, is as smart as a human, although the word was man at the time, right? But doesn't think like a human, right? She's very good at that. She's very good at, what was it? Brothers of Earth. That was a novel that I read of hers where it was exactly like that, Chandra. It was somebody coming to a different planet and they were the alien there and trying to adapt to the existing culture. And it was good. Like, you know, I think that's worth considering too. And that's cool because that allows us to have empathy for people who might be adjusting to a different culture. Like if you haven't gone outside of North America, which a lot of us don't here, I mean, like we're all North American, right? So, you know, if we haven't gone outside of North America, then we don't really know what we don't know. Now, I live in Canada. I went to Quebec, right? And it's still my country, right? But the language is different. The culture is different. Mm-hmm. The people are different. And there were lots of things that I just didn't know. And it was really interesting to be in the position where I was trying to figure it all out and trying to get along with my smattering of French that I learned from high school. And it was a good object lesson. And I think that space opera can be like that too, if we're looking at it from that perspective.
Yeah, I think so. Although I do want to point out that, and I'm not the first person to point this out by far, to be careful as writers, not to frame all of those issues as, well, the humans meeting aliens, because the implication, of course, is that us North Americans, we're humans, and everybody else isn't human. And so if we're always framing those encounters in terms of humans meeting aliens, that's a narrative pattern that I think becomes entrenched, and I don't think it necessarily has good effects down the line. If that were just a thing that happens sometimes, it wouldn't necessarily excite comment, but it's such a frequent pattern that oftentimes we don't see it. I didn't see it until somebody pointed it out to me and I went, oh my gosh, oh wow, that is a thing I need to think about. And so I think that's worth keeping in mind. But once again, one of the things space opera lets you do is create human cultures that are vastly different, that are vastly far apart, but that, in reality, they can't really come close to even the actual cultural differences on Earth. There are so many cultures, so many languages, so many different kinds of people here, but you can really create huge differences and play those up when you've got that huge canvas to work with. And once again, the important story is actually the story of the people, the individual people who are encountering each other and not necessarily the Galactic Emperor, right?
Right.
Yeah, you're right. The Galactic Emperor is only important in how he, she, or it affects the people, right? So, yeah. Good stuff. I agree with you.
Yeah, there's, I think, something we all tend to overlook, that's easily overlooked, is just how close we all are to aliens, in that in this day and age where travel is so much more common, where international travel is so much more common, I'm lucky I'm here in Los Angeles, where not only is it nice and warm and sunny out, but I'm also the only native English speaker in my entire block. So that you live with other cultures, and I have kind of sort of gotten to the point where I'm accustomed to being the weird foreigner in the room, because nobody else in the room is an American. They're American by choice, but they're not American by birth and cultural upbringing. And it can be, it's an eye opener on a lot of levels. But I think if we use space opera, we can use space opera, or part of what it could do is to just look at your neighbors and say, hey, you know, your neighbors are right there. If you want to look at this, creating a Mos Eisley cantina, we can do it. All you have to do is go listen to your neighbors, try to talk and listen to them, and listen to our social groups out here, where you've got Armenians and Russians who speak to each other very comfortably, because they all speak Russian, with Israelis and Iranians. Yeah. And it's a Tower of Babel. And you'll finding out that these supposedly disparate cultures have more in common with each other than they have with their adopted country. So that you learn to turn the perception around, and it helps you to look at this North American mindset from the outside. I hope I'm making sense here.
Do you find, Bonnie, that being surrounded by such a variety of culture, does that help enhance your space opera writing?
Oh, very much so, because it broadens the canvas. It allows me to paint with far more, more colors than I could otherwise, simply because I can find an example in terms of behavior. I can think, okay, if I'm trying to come up with this, if I know this one character is going to behave in a particular manner, it's like, okay, well, I can look outside, how do the Armenians do this? How do the Iranians do this? How would a Russian, forget the Russians. Let's go back to the Armenians and the Iranians. They're even weirder than the Russians. And I can look at that and then say, okay, from that perspective, how does, this white male North American kind of character, how does he look? Where is he weird? Is it that what he does that makes sense to us as North Americans make absolutely no sense whatsoever from another perspective? And it really does, I think, if we have that, I think it really allows us to explore even more of the elements and the potentials of space opera. And I think there's a lot of other genres that don't allow you to do that. Fantasy could do it, but I don't see that much of it in fantasy.
Yeah, fantasy tends to get stuck sometimes in that, European epic Tolkien-esque kind of pattern. Not always. There's lots of really, there's some very interesting stuff going on in urban fantasy, for example. We will have a panel on that in the future. But yeah, I see what you're saying, right? Although,
I was just going to say that depends on who's writing the fantasy.
Right, exactly.
That's
true. I would argue probably a little defensively, right, that my space opera is fantasy based, right? It's not science fiction, right? I chose to do everything. Yeah, I know, right? But I chose to do everything with a magical explanation as opposed to a scientific one, right? And so, it depends on the fantasy, right? It depends on who's writing it. So I don't know if we've covered that already, but have we talked about the setting, right, of space opera in particular, of using this broad space exploration setting? Did I miss that?
Kind of. We talked about how space opera often has that huge backdrop, right? But we didn't talk in detail about what kind of backdrop. I personally don't think it has to be any one particular kind of backdrop. I think the beauty and scope of the backdrop is the key part. But other folks have different feelings. And
I think for me, I don't think there's any specific definition for where it has to take place, but I think for me, it would be anywhere other than Earth. I mean, it could be in space. It doesn't have to be in space specifically, but not on Earth.
I think it can start on Earth, but it should be a journey away from Earth.
Sort of like encompassing all of Tolkien's kingdoms from the Shire, but we're using space and other worlds instead.
Yeah, okay, sure. I can groove with that. That makes sense to me. It's just, I wonder, why do we take it out there, right? And is that, you know, essential to space opera? Does that give it something? And then the question is, how exotic does it have to be? Second question, but related, so let's discuss this first one first. But the second question is something like, say, The Expanse space opera?
I consider it to be space opera, frankly. I know it's confined to the solar system, which technically is more realistic than traditional space opera. But the solar system's pretty freaking big. You can just stay in the solar system and have a ginormous canvas because it's huge. And I think they are working with a super huge canvas. They're not a lot of older science fiction or present science fiction, I guess, that works within the solar system kind of is more smaller feeling. For narrative convenience, you get places pretty quickly or things happen in transit only. But they have, I think, very deliberately sort of expanded out the solar system. Well, then, of course, it goes past. But I do think it's definitely space opera.
I don't know. I think the books are definitely space opera. The show, I guess, it doesn't feel as space opera-y as the books, but I guess.
I have not watched The Expanse or read the books, so I cannot comment on that.
Fair enough.
Thank you. There's two of us then.
Yeah, the books are on my TBR list, so I have been watching. Yeah, I'll get there someday. You know, you can see the stack. Yep. 3 years is similar, but yeah. Okay, so I have been watching the series. I'm a little bit behind. But I think it's an interesting case, right? Because I agree with Anne. I think it's space opera, right? And maybe I agree with Kalita too. I think maybe provisionally, right? And the thing is, maybe that's where the line is. Because the thing about The Expanse is, yes, it's not interstellar, right? It's interplanetary, right? And it's not, there's no magical technology in it, right? All the stuff that is going on in it, they're trying for ultra-realism, right? And there's no big, people don't always, there's not this do-gooder hero, right? Like, everybody's morally gray. There's no real good guy or bad guy. You know, I think some people make more gray decisions than others in the show, but none of them are wholly one thing or another. So, you know, but I would consider it space opera. I think it's kind of where the borderline is personally, right? So that's my feeling on it, but I couldn't really articulate the specifics of why. I think maybe, yeah.
I think that's part of it. I can't put a finger on the why of it. I do think Holder feels like a really pure kind of character to me. So I would say that he is, if there is any like good guy, he would be the good guy. I think the reason the books feel more space opera-y to me is because of, I guess I would have to reduce it more to how I feel when I'm reading the books. Things are moving a lot more quickly. There feels like there's a lot more action. It feels a lot grander, I guess. The shows move a bit slower. It takes more time sort of plotting things out. And it doesn't have, I guess, that sort of grand feel. I mean, there are things at stake and all of that is important, but it doesn't have that like great boom, like things are just happening and everything has to happen right now kind of feel that's happening in the books. Like everything in the books is just so fast. And I guess it's that feeling that I don't have. And I like them both the same. I probably maybe like the shows a little bit more because it is taking its time. I went through the book so fast that I can't remember like what happened in what book when, because I went through them so quickly. And I do like the pacing with the show a little bit better. But I think the books feel more space opera to me than the show. But I guess the show is space opera.
Would the show be similar to Dark Matter?
No, Dark Matter is, if I was to say which show was space opera, I'd say Dark Matter was more space opera.
Yeah, I would agree. Dark Matter is much more obviously space opera than The Expanse, in my opinion. And I do, The Expanse is kind of on a line because they do take the physics and stuff as seriously as they can. They have thought very hard about that. And one of our prerogatives as space opera authors is we don't have to if we don't wanna, right? Mm-hmm. And they have decided to do that, which gives it a sheen of coming from the harder end. But once you get that protomolecule in there, and once you've got, you know, some of the stuff going on in those books, those are not exactly careful, realistic extrapolations from known science, right? We're bringing in, you know, it's sufficiently advanced technology. That's magic, right?
Yeah, it gets wild. It just gets wild. It feels a lot more, it feels so much more careful and I guess so much more paced and careful in the show. And the books, it's just a wild race. It feels like a wild race to me.
I think the books are very sprawling, which is a thing books can do very well because you can, you know, you've got however many pages you want and you can throw in whatever narration you want and you can add little details very easily. You throw in a sentence here, a paragraph there, a scene there. When you're working with the time and space constraints of a television show or a movie, you've really got to pare it down to essentials. And so the feel is going to be very different, I think.
I think You also, I think, have to take away some of that extra information away. You've got to spend a lot of time, I think, in a show also making the viewers like those characters also, which you have a lot more time to do in a book in addition to everything else. So much time is spent making you like Holder and Naomi and all of those other characters. And that is just important as everything else. So I don't know, it just has a completely different feel. And I appreciate them both equally, but they do feel different to me, definitely. Dark Matter feels a lot more space opera to me. There's another show also, Killjoys is also super space opera, which I love.
Okay, so then the next question is that like why do we take it out to the stars? And why is this an essential element aside from the fact that space is in the title?
I think it's because we don't know what's out there. I think if you go back and look at adventure fiction, whoever's writing the adventure fiction sets it very often in the place that they think of as being distant and nobody knows where it is, so you can make mysterious and strange things happen. So to us, space is the ultimate, who knows what's out there? You can go far enough out there and there could be anything and we don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's an accident that stories about Martians stopped appearing after it became very clear to us that there were no Martians, right? Once we got those pictures from those probes saying there's nothing here but rocks, there's not even bacteria here, it'd been, as scientific knowledge had been catching up with it, they had become less. But we don't see those stories anymore of ancient civilizations and the canals of Mars, even though we could do that. We could write a Mars with canals and with ancient civilizations and Tars Tarkas with forearms and all this stuff. We could do that. Nothing's stopping us. But what's stopping us psychologically is the fact that we know that Mars isn't like that, but we don't know what's out there further out in the solar system. So you can set anything you want there. And I think people have probably always set those kinds of stories out in areas that, to whoever is telling the story and to their audience, are sort of unknown places where they can set any kind of story that takes their fancy.
Yeah, yeah, I agree. You can make anything happen in space, anything.
But I think there's another element to it as well, and that is the idea of boundless. Unlimited space, unlimited possibilities. That, as Anna's pointed out, many, many times, many for most of human history, that was the Wild West. That was the next country over. That was the unknown. But as we see more and learn more about our immediate vicinity, the unknown moves further and further out. When you're talking about deep space now, it's the whole universe suddenly relieves us of that sense of what's known. And so you push it further and further out to reclaim that sense of boundless possibilities.
I think that's a great point too. I'm getting an echo from somewhere. Yeah. Okay. So, we seem to have lost Chandra. Sorry. Yeah. Hopefully she'll be back.
Ladies, I'm going to wind up having to bow out here. I do have a scheduling conflict coming up.
Yeah, fair enough. We're actually, it's up to you if you guys want to continue. We're already half an hour past the time that we initially said that we were going to quit because we were half an hour late to start. Your call. I don't have anywhere I have to be, but that's up to you. If everyone has other places they have to be, you've all been such troopers today, and I thank you so much for all your patience and your willingness to proceed anyway and just kind of jump in, and I can't wait to hear what I've missed anyway.
I'm just thrilled to have been here. Thank you so much for giving me such a wonderful opportunity to meet at least one of my heroes. And
I know, I feel the same way. I'm like fangirling over here.
I'm doing the countdown, right? This has just been, it has just been so wonderful. Thank you so much, Diane, for thanking me. I really, really, really cherish the opportunity. I can't tell you how just delighted I am to have been part of this. And, if there's anything I can do to help or to support you guys going forward, just let me know. Let's not lose touch.
Yeah, it's been a lot of fun.
So I thank you again. Hugs and kisses to everyone.
Bonnie's link will be in the show notes, and so don't miss her work. Hey, we got to promote each other. Nobody else is going to do it, right?
That is so true. I have got to read, and I've already read your books.
you guys talk about your stuff.
I have to put this in there. I deal, because I speak Farsi, I deal with Armenians and Farsi, old ancient languages that do not have sex-driven pronouns. They don't have such standard pronouns. What actually happens is they use he and she interchangeably. You cannot imagine what it's like trying to follow a conversation in which one person changes sex four times. It's, my father, she is a nice man. And okay, guys. But it's take that, because it really will, it's inspiring. Real quick, since I do have to go, I've been allowed to talk about my stuff. My biggest space opera is Homeworld, and it basically is, we have met the enemy, he is us, but I set it in Waikiki following the basic destruction of Earth because of our tendency to create our own human cannon fodder. So in this world, humans have genetically engineered a combat-bred human polymorph, which finally turned on humanity and split off and just took the world apart. It's a space opera, it goes on. But it's basically, it's the story of Jessica Van Buren, who is now heir to Earth and has finally created a treaty with Earth's old enemies, the Lupins, who are the human polymorphs that tore Earth apart, to create an alliance that will allow Earth to come back as a power. But to do so, he has to get the chief Lupin to marry his sister. His sister is seriously xenophobic. And then he and Lord Strongarm, the chief Lupin, fall in love with the same girl. I can't tell it. I'm sorry. I can't tell it.
Hey, that's cool. I'm already interested. But, sounds good. I want to read it.
It won the Emmy Award. So it's one of the Reader's Choice Awards. And it's the basis. That universe is where all my other work is set, because it took me 18 years to work the world out. So that's it. I am definitely looking you guys up. What should I be looking for in your works? Give me some book titles here, guys.
Go ahead, Kalita. Your turn.
No books. I have a couple of short stories that are eligible for awards this year. Concessions, that was published with Strange Horizons last year, and that will also be published in Best of Anthology, edited by Jonathan Strahan, that will come out later this year. And the story that I co-wrote with Rachel K. Jones, that was published with Diabolical Plots last year, that will also be published in a year's best of this year, with Nightshade Books. And another story that's eligible for an award that was published with FIA last year, called Talking to Cancer.
Wow. That's pretty awesome. Congratulations on the year's best. Is the Nightshade one, is that Rich Horton's? That's really awesome.
No, that's with Neil Clark.
Oh, Neil Clark's. Okay.
Thank you.
I'm just getting started. So I'm a hybrid writer, and so, you know, a couple of small press things, but this year mostly I was concentrating on my Weird West Chronicles, which is a series of weird Western fantasy, it's like Firefly meets Shannara kind of Western type story. Yeah, it's different. Lots of people are like, oh, this just sounds too crazy, I don't even want to read this. And then they read it and go, oh, hey, that's pretty cool. So I don't know. I've been publishing it every couple of months on Amazon. It's because it's novellas and novelettes, and they have trouble finding homes. And I've got a couple of stories in my fantasy space opera, which is called The Toy Soldier Saga. I've been working on it for a while. The novels themselves, I'm working on, like, they're in consideration right now with a publisher, but nothing certain yet. But I've published a couple of related stories. One was called Survivor. It was in Sci-Fi magazine this summer. And the other one is a... well, it was in a romance and erotica anthology called Chasing Fireflies, a summer romance anthology, and it's a story of one of the important romantic relationships in that story. It's called Eye of the Storm. And it's basically World of Warcraft in space if everybody were in a Patrick O'Brien book.
Hmm.
It's elves and orcs in space at war.
Okay, now that's well, ladies, please accept my apologies. I have to sign off here because
That's great. That's cool. Thank you so much, Bonnie. You were awesome.
That was great.
This was a lot of fun. I look forward to catching the part I didn't catch, and thank you all for being so persistent. Please check everyone's links in the show notes. They will all be there with, you know, places you can find their work and their websites. And I really hope we all stay in touch too, because this was awesome. You guys need anything, you let me know, okay?
Thank you, by your sake. Mwah. Take care, guys. I got to run. I'm going to get shot.
Yeah, fair enough.
Bye-bye.
Final words, ladies, before we sign off.
Thank you.
Yeah, this was a lot of fun. I'm really glad that we did this.
Oh, yeah, I should mention, Anne did a course recently on writing space opera with in conjunction with Kat Rambo, and I will put the link to that in the show notes as well. They're not in there currently, but I will do that, because who wouldn't want to learn how to write space opera from Anne Leckie?
I was in one of those classes.
You were? That's right.
Yeah.
Was it good? I'm sure it was awesome. It was
awesome. Awesome.
Cool. Thank you very much. And we'll hopefully see everybody again on episode 3 of Spec Women Chat, which will be happening sometime in late March. The inaugural episode of the panel, which is basically this kind of idea, but for all genders, will be on the first weekend of March. Specific date and time to be announced. One of our panelists will be John Scalzi. And Kat Rambo will be another panelist. I don't know exactly who. We're still finalizing the last couple. And our inaugural episode will be What is Science Fiction? So I look forward to the screaming arguments that are probably
going to be a super easy question to answer. Take you 5 minutes. You can sit down and just have cookies after that.
Exactly, right? People writing literary criticisms for years and, you know, debates and, yeah. So it'll be fun. I'm really looking forward to seeing what we come up with. So thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
See you next time.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.